Good morning and welcome. Thank you for being part of our meeting today. This opens our official June FCC meeting. 9 days from DTV Transition. We're down to the single digits. In 9 days, full power analog broadcasting will come to an end in the United States. And it will come to an end. Anyone who thinks that there's a chance of another delay had better wake up and smell the converter box, I guess. this transition is taking place on June 12th, and this is not a drill. It is the real thing. The good news is that we are in considerably better shape now than we were just 4 months ago. We were nowhere near ready for a nationwide transition in February. Had we flipped the switch then, we would have faced a consumer debacle that would have made new Coke look like a stroke of marketing genius. This is not to say that the transition on June 12th will be problem-free. It will not. I have said it many, many times over the past 2 years, but it bears repeating, there will be disruption. There was no way we could accomplish in 4 short months what should have been done over the past 4 years. The hard truth is that we waited too long to deploy our maximum effort, and until recently lacked the intergovernmental cooperation and public-private partnerships necessary to effectively tackle the job. All that has changed. We won't be able to fix all of the problems that went unaddressed so long, but we can fix a lot of them, and we can make a real difference for consumers. You'll hear about many of these efforts today, better consumer outreach, call centers and walk-in centers where consumers can get help from real human beings, working with groups like AmeriCorps and local fire departments and others to provide in-home assistance to consumers who need it, providing accurate information to consumers about signal coverage and antenna issues. Many of these ideas were hatched in the wake of the mini-transition we experienced on February 17th and the nationwide soft test that was recently held, and the earlier test markets in Wilmington, North Carolina, and Hawaii. Actually, the delay has given us the chance to have something of the phase transition that I called for so long ago. Almost half of all full power stations will have transitioned before June 12th, and we've been trying to learn from each one of those and to feed those lessons back into the process. Some of what we're learning, frankly, makes me uneasy, especially this late in the game. We still seem to be learning, for instance, about how DTV signals propagate and how the VHF and UHF bands propagate differently. This is a perfect example of an issue that could have been and should have been identified and tested long ago, like years, rather than something we're scrambling to get our arms around days before the switchover. But overall, the delay has been worth it. Without a doubt, there are obvious signs of progress. The number of unprepared households continues to drop, and the massive coupon backlog has been cleared. Kudos to NTIA. Probably more than half of the unprepared households we had back in early February are now prepared. So while I have no doubt there will be some disruption, we are working every day, all day, to resolve everything we can between now and June 12th, and then in the important days immediately following June 12th. Behind the new systems we have put in place are people. None of this could have happened without a true team effort, and I want to again thank my two colleagues for all of their hard work and outreach and leadership. It's been really an incredible experience for me. Our FCC teams have just been absolutely incredible. I told them the other day this is the best team mobilization effort I have seen in my many years around this town. The next 10 to 14 days will be the busiest ones yet for these good folks, but what will get them through is the same commitment that they have shown since day one to get this job done as well as it can possibly be done. I also want to thank our friends at NTIA and our other public sector brethren. We couldn't ask for better partners. And, of course, our industry and private sector colleagues for their hard work. I've been to so many broadcast stations around the country and met with many broadcaster associations, and their leadership has been, and it will be now more than ever so in the days ahead, essential to our success. The June 12th transition really will be hundreds of local market transitions, and local consumers will be looking to local stations for a lot of help. I particularly want to commend those stations that have agreed to serve as analog nightlight stations in their market so that consumers who are not prepared for June 12th know where to turn for help. And I want to thank Dave Donovan of MSTV for his assistance in reaching out to those stations. Other industries, as we'll hear again today, have stepped up, as have consumer, civil rights, labor, church, and just really dozens of other groups. They have given us a breadth of outreach that would have been otherwise impossible to attain. Not to coin a phrase, but it truly does take a village. It also takes money. And I want to thank Congress and the President for recognizing that fact, and NTIA for sharing some of it with us. I realize that devoting resources on something like this opens us up to second-guessing almost no matter what happens. The truth is that no one knows for sure what will happen on June 12th. We can make our best predictions, but no one knows for sure how much disruption there will be and precisely what it will take to help consumers recover. So we're never going to get this exactly right. We won't have the perfect number of call center agents on duty or precisely the right number of boots on the ground in precisely the right places. When you get right down to it, you can risk either having too much help for consumers or having too little. And of course, we have to spend every penny wisely, but I know what side of that too much or too little ledger that I want to be on, and it's more rather than not enough. We have put consumers through enough of a ringer with the transition already, and shortchanging them on help when they need it is not part of this FCC's playbook. In the end, we will get through this, not without bumps, and emerge on the other side with better television service for consumers, as well as new spectrum for public safety and advanced wireless services. Those are going to be incredible gains, so it will be quite a feat when it's all done. Finally, for any folks who are listening out there who haven't set their boxes up yet and tried them out, or maybe haven't bought the box yet, or worse, haven't even ordered their coupons yet, do it now, today, this morning, immediately. You might not have time to make it a seamless transition in your house at this late date, but at least you can cut your losses and get that old analog set working for you in the digital age. For help, 1-888-CALL-FCC or on the web, www.dtv.gov. Thank you, and on to June 12th. Commissioner Edelstein?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. You're certainly right that we are in much better shape than we would have been on February 17th. That was very fearful, and looking back at it, we were certainly far from ready then, and we've done everything we possibly can in the short period we have to get ready now. So at last, the end of the transition, or at least the beginning of the end, is near. With just 10 days left before broadcasters shut off their analog and move to digital, we're really making this big final push to minimize the number of consumers left in the dark on June 12th. And although time is short, I know all of us are working overtime to make it a success. I was really thrilled that on May 21st, we held finally a coordinated nationwide soft test. I long ago called for us to help inspire a soft test along those lines, and it proved to be a big success. It reminded consumers that time's running out to prepare and encouraged coordination between broadcasters and local cable operators. In one day, our phone line got 55,000 calls, nearly four times the average that month. And we're using this information to target our outreach as we wrap up the national campaign. Of the calls we received, 51% needed information on the Converter Box coupon program, 15% had concerns about reception issues, and 10% needed Converter Box installation help. With the assistance of volunteers, broadcasters, grassroots organizations, and technical assistance contractors, we're continuing to educate consumers about these issues and give them the help that they need. And we're now specifically focusing on those regions we receive the largest volume of calls from, including Chicago, Fort Worth, and New York, in addition to other DTV hotspots. So I'd like to thank the broadcasters in the more than 125 communities that participated in the soft test. Broadcasters there and all across the country's shared commitment and cooperation in helping consumers has been invaluable throughout this process. It's really been a cross-industry effort, as we'll here today. I truly appreciate the leadership of public television, cable operators, consumer groups, civil rights groups, consumer electronics manufacturers and retailers, all of whom are going to share their views today, all of whom have really stepped up to the plate to make this work. So we've made some big strides in the last few months, and we're planning a strong finish in the home stretch during the weeks following the transition as well. I remember we remade our website, DTV version 2.0, which I helped to unveil at the NAB show out in Vegas. It was developed by our FCC staff, and it's as good as anything you could see in the private sector. It really helps guide not only consumers, but those who want to help consumers, people in the field. It's rich with consumer-friendly content regarding in-home installation services, DTV clinics, full-service walk-in centers, mapping and intent information. A lot of the things that activists need, that volunteers need, that people who are helping people need. So I want to thank Chairman Copps and the DTV Policy Group for their leadership over the last few months. It's been a team effort here in the whole commission, all of us working together, traveling all over the place. And Chairman Copps has devoted the resources necessary to put the transition in a position to succeed. To coin a phrase, we were in trouble and the cops came just in time. And Congress, of course, gave us additional time to get it right. And I'm proud to say we haven't squandered that opportunity. I want to recognize the army of FCC volunteers, people from our staff who've traveled far and wide to spread the word on DTV and to help people out there. They've been everywhere demonstrating, there's a song recently we heard about, they've been everywhere to hook up converter boxes, troubleshooting technical issues, and getting folks signed up for coupons. Just look at the numbers. As of April 30th, nearly 16,000 DTV-related visits to the public, more than 3,500 awareness sessions, and more than 19 million pages of DTV information distributed. An entire forest was destroyed for this purpose, but for good reason. And our staff here in Washington, who we'll hear from today, arrayed before us, have gone above and beyond the call of duty, working overtime, work that will long be remembered as an example of government at its best. And we thank you for all of your efforts. All this, of course, wouldn't be possible either without intergovernmental and industry coordination. More than ever, we're coordinating with the White House, and of course, we appreciate our friends at NTIA who've been seamlessly coordinating with us since January, and our industry partners to saturate the country with all things DTV. And we're seeing the fruits of a unified federal message and a coordinated national approach. Thanks to these players and with a strong assist from Congress, by delaying the transition, I've gone from praying for a good transition to actually believing one is possible. Even if there is going to be some disruption, I think it's going to generally go as well as we could have possibly hoped. Of course, the coming weeks, in order for that to happen, are going to see our most furious activity yet. In effect, June 12th is the beginning of the final phase of DTV work rather than the end. Commission staff and contractors will be working around the clock through that weekend afterwards to resolve any issues that arise for broadcasters and for consumers. Contract support for basic and enhanced in-home assistance and walk-in centers will continue after the transition, along with additional resources in our call center. So with precious little time left, we can't rest now. We're not resting now. We know that June 12th is a date that the unprepared and underprepared will really begin to experience the consequences of their lack of preparation. Seeing snow on TV sets across the country can be rare to see that much snow in June. And we're going to make sure that we get those people the help immediately to get them back on track as quickly as we can. So we'll need all eligible broadcasters, particularly those in DTV hotspots, at-risk markets, and others to participate in the analog nightlight program that Congress created. Households that lose their TV reception will lose more than just entertainment programming. They'll need access to crucial information on TV to help them make the transition. Also, access to local news and emergency information is critical, especially since now the transition is taking place just as the hurricane season is beginning. NOAA is expecting 4 to 7 hurricanes, and 1 to 3 of those to be major ones. So an analog nightlight station could be a matter of life and death. I strongly encourage all broadcast stations eligible to provide nightlight service to, in fact, enlist in providing their viewing audiences with this important public service. So as we approach the final laps of this long race, it's safe to say that we've served the American people well. If the DTV transition were a NASCAR race, 6 months ago, we were lagging behind, hitting walls, crashing and burning. Since then, we've got a pit stop and refueling from the administration and Congress. We've got a new driver, rebuilt the engine, and empowered the pit crew Today, we're zooming along and about to see the checkered flag.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't have any prepared remarks. I want to save some additional time for questions for our panelists because I'll have lots of those. But as I'll incorporate by reference many of the things my distinguished colleagues said, and I want to thank them for their leadership throughout all this and all the folks that they thanked as well. I've said for a long time that the DTV transition will be messy regardless of when the analog cutoff date is. It will be messy. We are estimating, 3 million households or so will be left behind. So at this point, I'll be really focusing on what our mopping up campaign will look like and how are we going to identify those 3 million or so households and get them help as quickly as possible. One area of concern I have, too, of course, has been all along our call center. And the May 21st nationwide soft test was a good stress test, as Commissioner Adelstein called it a few weeks ago, for our call center. And I do know that we had higher than expected call volume in some regards at that time. And I've heard anecdotal evidence that some callers had to wait 20 or 30 minutes before they could get their questions answered, and there was a high rate of drop-off calls. So one concern I have is to make sure that we have the adequate funding we will need to fund 4,000 operators for about a 10 to 12 day period there before and after June the 12th. And I'll be asking whether or not that funding is forthcoming from the Department of Commerce, upon whom we depend for that funding. Because 51% of the calls that the FCC call center fields are regarding the coupon program, which of course is administered by the Department of Commerce. So it's important that we don't keep consumers waiting, that this fundamental tool that consumers whose TVs will be useless to them after the 12th, they will have no television means through the television of receiving information about how they can help themselves or others may be able to help them after that point. So how are we going to get them this information? How will we locate them? How will we know where they are so we can help them? And having that funding to make sure our 1-888-CALL-FCC call center is up and running with adequate staffing is going to be paramount in my mind. So also we need to focus on what sort of surprises we might have. Of course, we don't know what we don't know, as the old saying goes. But what can we anticipate might go wrong? What do you need that you don't have right now that we can give you here in the final minutes? If there's anything you need that you don't have to do your jobs adequately, I want to hear it now. There could be some surprises. For instance, I understand there might be 30 or more TV stations that have just gone dark, that have just gone out of business, that are just turning in their licenses. Will there be more? This is the severest economic downturn for the country in a long time, but for broadcasters, perhaps since the invention of broadcasting. This has been too much for many broadcasters, so they're literally turning in their licenses. So how will that affect our transition as well? So if there's anything else we can foresee, let's try to foresee it now and take care of it now, because we're down to the final seconds on the shot clock. So, and for those of you who heard the chairman's advice to act today, which, of course, we've been saying we've been blue in the face for months and months now, act today. But by the way, if you order a coupon today, it's probably not going to get to you by June the 12th. So unless you really need the coupon, part of the message I've been saying, unless you really need the coupon, just buy your box today and get it hooked up today, because broadcasters are broadcasting in digital today. And let's also keep in mind the benefits. The number one question I get as I go around the country talking about this is, why is the government doing this to me? You'll get a better picture quality, better sound quality, and more channels all for free over the air. Plus, we have all that reclaimed spectrum that we auctioned off in the 700 megahertz auction, and that's going to benefit consumers here in a couple of years. So keep that in mind, that hopefully a few months from now we'll be talking about the benefits of DTV and not all the pain and the stress that we've gone through to get there. But in any case, I will reserve the rest of my time for some questions, Mr. Chairman, and look forward to hearing from our panelists.
Thank you very much. Madam Secretary, I think we already have a clue what's on our agenda for today, but would you like to formally announce what we're going to be doing?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning. Good morning, commissioners. Today's agenda consists of two panel presentations by senior agency officials, as well as industry, consumer groups, and others involved in the digital television transition. The first panel will feature Commission and NTIA reports on the events of the status of the digital television transition and prospects for June 12, 2009. The second panel will feature industry and consumer group reports on the status of the digital television transition and prospects for the June 12, 2009. This is your agenda for today.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. One further administrative detail. At the conclusion of the panels today, Commissioners Alstein and McDowell and myself are going to join together and conduct a traditional post-meeting press briefing. And in addition to taking questions from the reporters who usually attend the meeting, we have also invited reporters from around the country to watch the meeting on our internet site and email questions to us that they may have about the DTV transition. I thank them in advance for their interest and for their participation, and if any of them doesn't have the email address to send those questions, it should go to dtvcountdown@fcc.gov, dtvcountdown@fcc.gov. Now, before we proceed to the formal panels, let me turn it over to our colleague and friend Bill Lake, who has done an outstanding job of helping coordinate our efforts here at the Federal Communications Commission, and he's going to give us a brief overview of where we are and whither we may be headed. Bill?
Thank you, and good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. The Commission staff has been working very hard in cooperation with NTIA to help inform TV viewers of the need to act before June 12. We've also reached out to provide assistance to those who need some help in getting ready. For many of the staff, this has meant repeated nights away from home or weeks away from their usual duties. In an outpouring of energy that I, as a relative newcomer to the Commission, have found quite remarkable. We've made real progress in reducing the number of households across the country that are not ready for the transition. But an estimated 3 million homes are still at risk of losing their TV reception if they don't act in the next 9 days. Our goal is to reduce that number as low as possible, though we know we won't get it down to zero. Analog broadcasting by full-power TV stations will end on June 12, but our work will not. All the types of assistance we are providing today will remain available after that date to help people who fail to act in time, to catch up and get their TV service back, or to help them with reception problems. To provide a summary of where we are today and what we'll be doing in these final days, we have at the table Eloise Gore, Associate Chief of the Media Bureau, Kathy Seidel, Chief of the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau, Andrew Martin, Chief Information Officer of the Commission, Julius Knapp, Chief of the Office of Engineering and Technology, and Dr. Bernadette McGuire-Rivera, Associate Administrator of NTIA, with whom we've been collaborating very closely. Eloise Gore will lead off.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. At the last DTV status report to the Commission on March 5th, we described the lessons learned from the partial transition on February 17th, 2009, and the next steps for implementing the DTV Delay Act. On March 13, 2009, the Commission adopted and released the third report and order to complete the regulatory steps associated with the delay in the transition deadline. In particular, we established the procedures for stations that wanted to terminate analog service before the deadline and revised our consumer education requirements to reflect both the changes in date and the topics of most importance to educating viewers, including information about potential loss of signals for some viewers. I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you today about our status as we count down the last 9 days to June 12th. First, some numbers, and a caveat that numbers are dynamic as stations change their circumstances. This is a snapshot. They do change. Although stations were permitted to terminate their analog service before the upcoming June 12th deadline, most stations chose to continue broadcasting in analog until the deadline. To date, 784 stations have terminated their analog service. Six more will terminate between now and June 12th, and 21 stations were always digital only. 18 markets, including Guam, have fully transitioned out of 210 markets. Thus, on June 12th, the remaining 974 full-power stations will terminate regular analog programming. 100 stations will continue to broadcast an analog signal to provide nightlight service for their viewers. More about them in a moment. The Commission allowed stations to choose the time of day on June 12th when they would end their regular analog programming and notify us of the day part. They chose as follows: 175 between midnight and 6 a.m., 200 between 6 a.m. and noon, 152 between noon and 6 p.m., and 447 between 6 p.m. and 11:59 p.m. Unfortunately, as Commissioner McDowell noted, there are approximately 35 stations that are currently broadcasting an analog signal that are expected to be dark after June 12th, and seven of these are affiliates of a major network. 20 of the stations going dark are owned by a company that is in bankruptcy at the present time. We are working with these stations in an effort to reduce the number that will be dark and the length of time they will be off the air. We understand that some of these stations will be available to their viewers on a subchannel of another digital station serving the area. We will also make sure that our phone center and our field staff are aware of these stations so that they can assist viewers who are asking questions about where the stations went. Finally, we want to thank the 100 stations that have volunteered so far to provide nightlight service for up to 30 days after June 12th. The statutory nightlight was enacted last December in the Short-Term Analog, Flash, and Emergency Readiness Act, which we call the Analog Nightlight Act. The act permits stations to keep their analog signal on for up to 30 days following the end of the transition solely for the purpose of providing emergency and DTV transition information. Stations operating in analog on channels 2 through 51 are eligible to participate in the program, provided they are not moving to their analog channel for digital service and would not cause harmful interference to other digital television stations. The nightlight will provide critical information for any viewers who do not have or have not installed the necessary equipment to receive digital broadcasts by the transition deadline. The Commission adopted and released the Analog Nightlight Order implementing the Nightlight Act on January 15th in anticipation of the February 17th deadline. And after the DTV Delay Act changed the deadline, the Commission concluded that the 30-day period applicable to the Analog Nightlight program will apply following the new June 12th transition deadline and therefore will run from and including June 13th through July 12th, 2009. On May 13th, the Media Bureau released a public notice outlining the statutory analog nightlight program and including a list of the stations that are eligible to participate. Public notice encouraged eligible stations to volunteer to provide the nightlight and describe the procedures by which they may notify us of their participation. The Commission recognizes that there are significant costs associated with continuing to operate analog transmission equipment after June 12th, and we commend the 100 stations agreeing to provide this important service for their viewers. Thanks to these broadcasters, 64 markets will have at least one nightlight station, including 42 of the 49 target hotspot markets. This means that over 69% of TV households in markets that have not yet transitioned will have a nightlight station in their market. More than half of the nightlight stations will stay on for the full 30 days. The others will be on for at least 2 weeks. I want to echo what was said by the commissioners in thanking David Donovan from MSTV for his extraordinary assistance with the process of identifying willing participants. We will be issuing the final list by early next week so that we can give more stations a chance to volunteer. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to provide this brief status report on behalf of the Media Bureau. We still have more ahead of us, and we very much appreciate your support.
Thank you very much. Ms. Sandell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, for allowing me this opportunity to report on the FCC's DTV outreach efforts and plans for the 9 days remaining before the June 12th transition and the days after. As you know, the FCC has visited every state and every DMA in the country to educate consumers and to help them prepare for the transition. Initially, these efforts were aimed at building awareness, answering questions about why the transition is taking place, and helping consumers apply for converter box coupons. Over time, we added more focus on converter box demonstrations and installations. As a result of consumer experiences on February 17th, we added emphasis on scanning and rescanning one's converter box and on adjusting one's antenna. And in recent months, we have been stressing more and more the need for consumers to take action and to act now. Well, the time is nearly here. We are focusing our remaining outreach efforts on reaching the people who are not yet prepared and who need our assistance in making the transition. And with time of the essence, we are going to places where we know these consumers, those in the most at-risk constituency groups, will be, and helping them there. So, for example, we have been attending church suppers, barbecues, and bingo nights. We've been conducting events outside the entrance to amusement parks, roller rinks, and at soccer games. We've been reaching consumers at ethnic festivals, including Cinco de Mayo, as well as through numerous street fairs. As you will soon hear, FCC staff members have been going to veterans hospitals around the country. FCC representatives have also conducted outreach at various tribal community centers and at various tribal events. As you will also hear, we also have two tribal events coming up next week, one with the Cherokee Nation in Oklahoma and one at Pine Ridge in South Dakota. We have been conducting converter box demonstrations at shopping malls, retail locations, and grocery stores, especially in areas having a high number of consumers in the at-risk constituency groups. We continue to work with various civic organizations, including the Boys and Girls Clubs, Rotary Clubs, Kiwanis, and we continue to work with the Salvation Army. We have also visited a number of low-income housing projects to help sign consumers up for coupons and demonstrate how to install their converter boxes. And recognizing that some consumers who sign up now may not receive their coupons in time to purchase and install their converter box before June 12th, at our events, we are also encouraging coupon donations. That way, consumers who truly need the $40 assistance can benefit from one of those donated coupons without having to wait the approximately 9 days to receive the coupon in the mail and potentially run the risk of being without television for some period of time. Now I would like to show you a video of three of our FCC employees who have been conducting DTV outreach and assisting consumers around the country. Alma Hughes, Cece Seppings, and Shayna Barehand. I know our time today is limited. Otherwise, I would have many, many more FCC staff members sharing their experiences as well. It is truly a dedicated and impressive team of FCC staff who have been working on this initiative for weeks, months, and in some cases, years. Following the story shared by the three FCC staff members, you will see a video of some firefighters who are working with the FCC to install converter boxes for consumers in their homes and at the same time checking the consumer smoke detectors. To date, we have 57 fire departments serving 194 different zip codes who have signed on to assist with this effort. We expect more departments to sign up in the coming days and are thankful for our partnership with the International Association of Fire Chiefs in this regard. Through their commitment, the commitment of our AmeriCorps volunteers, the work of our FCC contractors performing in-home assistance and walk-in centers, and the support of our own FCC staff, we are trying to ensure that consumers will have access to the help they need to take the necessary action. The video, please.
Hi, my name is Alvin Hughes. I'm with the Federal Communication Commission working on a DTV project since November of last year, a project that I found much happiness and joy in doing. On last week, Friday of last week, I was in St. Louis visiting the seniors. The seniors, they had a program or they had an event out in the park, which they call the Older Americans Event. It's where they were celebrating Older Americans Month for the seniors. Now, I was sitting there, I had my table all set up with all the DTV prompts, and it's like I'm waiting for someone to come back to see me. The lady who was in charge of the event, she came back, she pulled me up, she said, why don't you go up and speak? I went up and speak. And I started speaking to the seniors. I told them the reason why we were there, what we can do for them, and that just I need to get them pumped up. Then I say June 12th. They said June 12th, and I told them what June 12th meant. And as I went on talking, I said, say June 12th. They said June 12th again. So I went on speaking. I said, now I need you all to come back to the table, and I need you to sign up for your coupons, ask any questions you want to ask. Right when I was finishing, I was walking off. I said, what's the date? They said, June 12th. And as soon as I got back to my table, I had two long lines of seniors waiting to sign up for their coupons. That is my great story thus far. Thank you.
I'm Cece Seppings, and I'm with the DTV Northeast team. In our region, we had a lot of emphasis on veterans, and we attended a lot of DTV clinics at veterans' hospitals. The most amazing experience I had, most touching one, was we were in a clinic in Manhattan, downtown Manhattan. There's this huge VA hospital, and the veterans were coming up, checking out what we were doing. And listening to the spiel, I noticed there was this one guy on the periphery, one veteran. And after the crowd dispersed, he came over and asked me, listen, I heard what you were saying to the other guys about getting a coupon, and I was wondering if you could help me. I have been recently unemployed, and I need help to get my TV, and can you help me? And I said, yes, sir, of course we can help you. Let me get your information. We can show you how to set up a converter box, and we can sign you up for a coupon right away, and it'll get in the mail, and you can get that box and get connected. And he was relieved. You could tell by the look on his face. So I said, can you give me your address? And he said, oh, you know, I don't really know it off the top of my head. I just got it. I've been a little down on my luck lately. And I said, that's no problem. He gave me a piece of paper that had his new address on it. And I looked at the paper, and I quickly got his information in and typed in the information and hit send with the computer. And then I looked at the letterhead on the letter, and I saw that it said New York Department of Homeless. And I was really concerned. I really wanted to make sure that this guy, this soldier, a veteran, got his coupon. And I was really worried because things hadn't been going that well that day. And when the number came up approved, I was like, all right, you've got your approval, and you're going to get your box. And he said, he looked at me and he said, thank you very much for taking the time to come out here, because sometimes we get a little worried because we don't have everything we need, and that helps. And I could tell that the guy was really grateful, and that made me realize why I got into public service in the first place. And that's my story.
Hi, my name is Shayna Barahan. I'm Mono Indian. I'm the liaison to tribal governments here at the FCC. And I'm here to tell you about the DTV outreach that we've been doing in Indian Country. Currently, we have two huge high-profile events on Pine Ridge in Oklahoma, the Cherokee Nation in Oklahoma, planned for the last week of the DTV transition to go out with a bang. I've been privileged to go out to many grassroots tribal events and talk to elders about setting up their converter box and being ready for the transition. A lot of our elders still watch over the air TV because it's free and it's the way that they stay connected to the rest of the world. And that's one of my fabulous mini stories. Thank you.
You can go ahead and display the firefighters video clip. Hmm. What I can do while they're waiting to find that clip is continue on, and then hopefully at the end they will find the clip and can show it. I think based on the videos you saw from our three FCC staff people, which really are indicative of many, many stories that our people have to share, I think one cannot help but be moved by the enthusiasm and commitment conveyed in their stories. And we know that our work won't be over on June 12th. We will continue to provide assistance to consumers after this date through our FCC toll-free number, through contractors continuing to provide in-home installation assistance, and through walk-in centers, and through the continued work of our people in the field as warranted. The breadth of the FCC's efforts has spanned the country, from Fairbanks, Alaska, to Portland, Maine, from Fargo, North Dakota, to Laredo, Texas, from Salinas, California, to Miami, Florida, and so many small towns and major urban areas in between. FCC staff have been doing their part to help consumers prepare for the transition, and we will continue to do so after June 12th for consumers who, for whatever reason, fail to act by then and still need our assistance. Is the video ready? Nope. If they catch it, maybe at the end of the panel we can show it. Otherwise, it was a great video, and we are thankful for the relationship and the partnership we have with the International Association of Fire Chiefs, which has allowed us to reach so many local communities around the country. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to provide an update on the Commission's efforts surrounding call center support for the upcoming DTV transition. With the passage of the DTV Delay Act, the Commission was afforded the opportunity to address specific enhancements to its approach for call center operations. These enhancements focused on increasing the flexibility of agent staffing, fostering interagency integration, managing language support, and increasing consumer responsiveness. The FCC's call center operation consists of two primary components: agents supported locally within the FCC's DC and Gettysburg facilities, and agents supported in a network of contracted facilities across the country. Throughout the DTV transition efforts, we have maintained a core pool of FCC-based agents to address a constant demand of consumer DTV inquiries. For both the February transition event and the upcoming June transition event, we have augmented that in-house capacity with a cadre of contract agents. For the June event, we have designed a flexible contract that allows the FCC to respond as necessary to unpredictable call volumes. This flexibility allows the FCC to respond by adjusting agent staffing levels as call demand varies. We have developed a two-tier agent pool that allows the Commission to efficiently address consumer inquiries with appropriately trained agents. We are increasing the agent workforce to 4,000 agents. 3,000 agents will be trained to address inquiries at the Tier 1 level. 1,000 will be trained at the Tier 2 level. All of these agents will be trained and available by June 10th. During the past few months, we have further improved our call center integration with our partner agencies' call center operations. For the February transition event, compressed time horizons only permitted development of a one-way interconnection between the FCC and the NTIA. That is, when consumers contacted the 1-888-CALL-FCC number, they were provided an option to directly transfer to the NTIA's automated coupon ordering system. We have now expanded this interconnection so that consumers also have the opportunity to transfer directly to one of the FCC's agents from the NTIA's 1-888-DTV-2009 number. Since this change was put in place, we have seen, at times, over 2,400 consumers per day opting to speak to an agent. One critical capability we sought to enhance for the June transition was an increase in our capacity to address multiple languages. In February, the Commission principally supported English and Spanish language calls, with only limited resources to address additional languages. For the June transition, we will continue to support English and Spanish language through contract agents at a ratio of 70% English agents and 30% bilingual Spanish-English agents. In addition to this capability, agents have the ability to conduct three-party calls with a translation service. This increases our language support to more than 100 languages. We've also taken concrete steps to improve our responsiveness to consumers. One particular area of focus has been agent skill level and knowledge. During the February transition event, we only had sufficient time to train agents for 24 hours. The DTV Delay Act provided us with enough time to train our agent pool more extensively. By analyzing both the training received by agents hosted within the FCC's facilities and the DTV material, we have developed both 40-hour and 80-hour training programs tailored to the agent's required skill level. This increased training better prepares the agents to answer the consumer's questions effectively and efficiently. The breadth of consumers' potential DTV inquiries demonstrates that some consumer interactions can quickly migrate to very technical discussions. Our training curriculum addresses the most likely inquiry scenarios, However, the curriculum also trains agents in a diagnostic methodology so that agents can walk consumers through specific steps to address their questions. As Commissioner Alstey noted, consumers are also able to take advantage of the wealth of DTV information available on a revamped DTV.gov website. In addition to preparing a more trained agent workforce, we are in the process of simplifying the consumer's experience within the Commission's call center menu options. We made an initial effort in February to speed the consumer to a live agent. We will shortly make changes to further improve this aspect of the consumer's experience. For example, with our current menu options, a consumer takes approximately 1 minute and 20 seconds to reach an agent. The new menu system will move the consumer to a live agent in approximately 30 seconds. The items discussed here are only a few of the enhancements we have put in place as we prepare ourselves for the transition on June 12th. Thank you for this opportunity, and I look forward to answering any questions you may have.
Thank you, Andrew. Julie Snapp.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I'm pleased to report on some of the steps we have taken to help address DTV reception and technical issues. The Commission's DTV mapping tool, which is available on the Commission's website, has been a smash success, enabling consumers to type in their address or zip code and obtain a list of the stations available at their location. We've promoted the use of the DTV mapping tool in various FCC publications and have trained our consumer and mediation specialists on how to use the mapping tool. Many consumers are concerned about whether they may need a new antenna, and if so, what guidance can we provide about the antennas that they may need? We reached out to a number of major antenna manufacturers and spoke with the industry technical experts to get a better grasp on antenna technical issues. I'd like to particularly credit Jonathan Levy and Sunal Mittal of the Office of Strategic Planning for taking the initiative on this project. There were several lessons that were learned from this effort. We cannot underscore enough that most consumers will need an antenna that is designed for both UHF and VHF reception. We had previously assumed that most consumers would have a VHF antenna, but might not have a UHF antenna. We've learned that some consumers, thinking that all of the DTV signals would be on UHF channels, purchased UHF-only antennas. When stations transitioned to their final VHF channels, some consumers found that they did not have an antenna capable of receiving them. We've also gained insight into the fact that there's wide variation in the performance of antennas. Some antennas that are listed as VHF, UHF, exhibit weak performance in receiving the VHF channels. In light of this information, we're updating our frequently asked questions and consumer information guide on antennas. And one of the points that we emphasize is that consumers should consult with their retailer for guidance on the antenna that best meets their needs. To assist the retailers, we've added guidance to our website on how they can use the DTV mapping tool to assist consumers to select the right antenna for their location. We've also added information for antenna manufacturers to help them ensure that the right kinds of antennas get to the right areas. I'd like to recognize John Gabrish and Allison Epluck for their work on this project. We're also in the process of updating the more detailed maps that are available on our website that compare the digital and the analog TV coverage. The original maps, which were published last December, were based on a snapshot of the facilities that were authorized as of October 3rd, 2008. The new maps are based on a more recent snapshot of the facilities that were authorized as of April 30th, 2009. We've created maps showing what the coverage will look like on June 13th, in other words, the day after the transition, as well as maps showing what coverage will look like when each station completes its authorized maximized facilities. The new maps will be available on our website shortly. Lastly, we've conveyed the message that people will need to rescan their DTV converter boxes and TV sets that use an antenna on the day of the transition as well as the day afterwards when all of the channels have settled into their final homes. Many of the stations will be moving from one radio frequency channel to another, and if you don't rescan, you're going to be missing channels that have moved. Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, in anything as technically complex as the DTV transition, there are bound to be some problems. We've put together a team of engineers from the Media Bureau and the Office of Engineering and Technology who will be standing ready on the day of the transition and beyond, as long as necessary, to diagnose and help resolve whatever technical problems may arise. This concludes my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions afterwards. Thank you
very much, and we're happy to welcome our friend, Dr. Bernadette McGuire Rivera from the Department of Commerce's NTIA. Thank you for being here.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. Speaking on behalf of Secretary Locke and Acting Assistant Secretary Gomez, we want to thank you for inviting us to participate in this hearing and for working with us as we reach a smooth transition. I'll go quickly over where we are in terms of our numbers and what we've done with the consumer education campaign and the process improvements that we had talked about at the last hearing. Right now, 31 million households have requested coupons. We've distributed 58 million coupons, and right now we estimate that there are about 6.5 million active coupons on the street. Retailer participation in the program remains strong. I also want to make a really special effort to recognize our NTI grantees. At this point in the transition, it's very important that consumers who aren't ready receive either hands-on assistance, or unfortunately there are people who are left do not have the means to even get the $20 for a coupon. And our grantees have really made, in addition to the walk-in centers and the help, over the past month or so have made a real effort to get these coupon exchanges going. And they've been very successful in that. The aging associations have coupon exchanges in 21 cities. LCCR has made a really great effort with their coupon exchanges, and Erica Swanson will be on the next panel to talk about that. In fact, those of you who are online a lot will see she sent out, she's got a very good online campaign going to really push for people to make coupon donations. Now, as you'll recall, one of our tactics was the transit ads. They were in 21 cities, 200 shelters. In all, right now, we estimate that over 44 million people have seen the transit ads on the buses. And we'll run through quickly, see a picture of the buses. We've got them on the sides of the buses, in the buses, on the benches, and in the transit shelters. And for Commissioner Adelstein, I would like to report that we have had no accidents or crashes with our buses. Our paid advertising has been really focused on minority and ethnic media outlets to reach these vulnerable populations, and we estimate that 93.5 million impressions have resulted from this paid advertising. Now, we also have our mobile assistance centers. Right now, they've been in 15 different cities. They've done 99 unique events, and we have been able to provide hands-on assistance to 20,000 consumers through this. And when they come to the booth, they are basically looking for installation and reception assistance as well as coupons. I'll quickly run where we were on week one and week two. Okay, week three, this is where we've yet to go. We've got Albuquerque, which is a key target market, Fresno, Joplin, Des Moines, Akron, Seattle, Phoenix, McAllen, Indianapolis, Baltimore. And speaking for the agency, our van will be there, and we've invited Commissioner Adelstein to take a drive if he's in any of these cities. The van also has been very safe. Here's a picture of the van and the booth in Houston. And also, we've been very pleased. Secretary Locke has just really been great. He has brought this up to a cabinet-level issue. He has been speaking. This is a picture of him in Sacramento, which was one of the hot spots and one of our key target markets, meeting with Congressman Matsui. There's also the mayor of Sacramento and the gentleman from the Urban League. And working with the FCC, there's been a very good effort to reach out to mayors, because I think we all found in our target groups in our research that people would like to hear not so much from a celebrity anymore, but they'd like to hear from somebody local that they trust. And letters have gone out from both agencies, and we've been coordinating, getting the mayors involved. Yesterday, the staffs from both agencies gave a webinar for the staffs of members of Congress to give them some last-minute advice on how to handle constituent calls that they may get over the course of the end of the transition. And this next picture, people are serious. They need help. This As you can see, this woman came in and brought her TV in a grocery cart to one of our transition centers, and we helped her, showed her how to put on the box, and she went home, and she was happy. The social media texting has also gone pretty well, and we've had people come to the MAC and say they saw the social texting. We've been doing it. Sporting events seem to be pretty good. We've been doing it at a lot of the farm game, baseball games, and although it's not been a major part of the campaign, we found it to be useful. And now, what will we be doing as we get to the end? Because the messaging is going to have to change, particularly with regard to the coupons that, as several people have noted, the coupons will not we have more coupons, but the chances, if you order it today with the 9 days processing, you might not get it by the 12th. So now when people call, we want to make sure that they know that it might not arrive on the 12th, that there are steps that they can take to get a box now, to at least have one television working through the transition. And again, we also keep pushing this coupon donation. Now, as of June 13th, our message is going to change again. We will be telling people that they can still order a coupon. You'll still be able to get a coupon through July 31st. July 31st is the last day that someone can order a coupon. And we want to push again that it expires in 90 days, so they have some time to use it. And again, the donation, while it's illegal to sell the coupons, they can use a coupon that was donated to them by someone else. And also at that time, we will really, again, continue to push even more scan for channels. And we've been thinking and talking to tell people to scan for channels at least every 2 weeks because different stations will be moving at different times. Hey, so what is this all working? Nielsen had numbers out last week. And if you look back to the end of January, which for the coupon program was sort of where we wanted to look back, because that's when everything had sort of stalled. We had a big waiting list. At that time, there were 5.7% of the households were not ready. As of this last week, 2.7% overall are unready. Within our target groups, the percentage is somewhat high. It's higher than it is in the general population, but as if you look at the figures, there has been substantial progress made in bringing down that unreadiness figure in each of those target groups. Particularly with the seniors, that's one group where I think we've both been very successful, but the people who are left who are seniors are the ones who need the hands-on help, so we are not stopping that in any way. Also, we're starting to look at the Nielsen numbers in terms of what's going on in our target markets, and I just picked some of the ones that had some pretty high unreadiness figures. Again, you can see that the unreadiness has decreased, a lot of them about half in these selected target markets. And if you also look just, you know, from what we know in these markets, that a lot of these markets are markets that have Spanish language stations and also have a lot of low power stations. So we're trying to look a little more depth into these target markets to understand not only, you know, how it can help them more, but what really does success mean and what these figures mean in terms of the target markets. The soft test was very helpful. What we have here, that's the daily coupon request. The red line is the total number of coupons. The blue line is the number of households. The first spike is May 21st. The next spike you see is the Tuesday after Memorial Day. We found since the beginning of the coupon program, the Monday or the first day back to work is the highest day for ordering coupons. So we went up about 25% on the soft test. The next Monday, it was about that. And then this Monday, we saw a real jump. That was just, you know, the day before yesterday. It's very high. When I looked at the numbers this morning, it came down just a little bit to about 116,000 a day. So in addition, it looks like I would make a prediction that I think the procrastinators are starting to move, and the people who didn't believe us now. And so I think we're going to have a good transition. And also, one of the things that we're going to be focusing on over the next couple of weeks is, I know we all talk about coordination, and the way things are now, coordination's more than just a weekly meeting. There are so many people on the street, all of the leadership is out making public appearances, And so we're working really hard. It's not just coordinated. It's like serious logistics to make sure that everybody is making the best use of their resources. So we look forward to working with you, and thank you for including us in the hearing, and I'll be happy to answer your questions later.
Thank you all. Bill, did you have anything further?
No.
All right. Okay, well, first of all, thank you very much, and I've had occasion to do this personally, but I want to do it publicly, is to thank Secretary of Commerce Locke for the way he has engaged and really been a real leader in this effort. And he just took office a few weeks ago, and the first time I called over to talk to him, they said, oh, he's downstairs doing some video on DTV, so I knew right away that he was really serious about this, and I know he's traveled extensively throughout the country, and he's been a tremendous leader in this, so we thank him for that. I know my colleagues have some number of questions. I'll just ask a couple of quick ones here. Ms. Gore, you mentioned that a number of stations, 35, will unfortunately be going dark. You think, and you mentioned that some of their programming might be available on sub-channels, and for the benefit of anybody who may be watching and is not familiar with what that might mean, could you give a little explanation of what you're talking about there?
Yes, certainly. One of the excellent things about digital service is that in the same amount of spectrum that television stations today use for one analog programming stream, they can have multiple programming streams. That's true even if they have an HD stream, they can have additional SD streams. The number varies. But many stations, and more of them, are doing what we call multicasting, and they have multiple streams available. So they have their own programming on one. Some stations, as you probably know, have perhaps weather information or local sports or something of that sort on their second and third streams. The public stations have a lot of multiple educational information. Our understanding is that in these market areas, there are brother and sister stations, not actually related, but assisting each other, that cover the same area. And so instead of using their additional multicast capacity for some other programming that they might provide, they are affording the opportunity for those stations that would otherwise be dark to use that capacity, those additional streams, to be broadcast over the air in digital so that their viewers can receive them. So, for example, if the station that's on the air, their channel number is 20, their own stream would be 20.1. And then the station that doesn't have its own facility might be perhaps 20.2. And another station might be perhaps 20.3. And this is easily obtained over the air by just clicking up on your remote control. So in this way, they can share the spectrum for a temporary period of time. This is used in many instances, and it's very helpful and very excellent that the stations are working together this way. I also wanted to add, when I said the numbers are dynamic, I'm not kidding. I apologize to my colleagues for checking my BlackBerry while I'm up here, but I wanted to get the most up-to-date information. So the number 35 is the right number. However, my understanding is that 10 of those have already terminated their analog service. So as far as people losing a station on June 12th, that would be 25 of them. And I've also been corrected, 18 of them are for financial reasons. This is 18 of the entire 35. 17 of them are a problem with equipment or delays of that sort, and so that should be remedied pretty quickly.
So some of those will be coming back?
Yes, absolutely.
Right. Okay. And then just one question for Julius Knapp. I get emails just about every day from consumers who are struggling with reception issues, and many are frustrated because they receive signals in analog and they don't seem to be able to find them in digital. And obviously some of this may be because of antenna issues or the box is connected wrong. But what are we learning, and just to kind of educate people a little bit about kind of the vagaries of the signal and the differences between analog and digital signals, the way they propagate between the VHF and the UHF band, and what advice do you have for consumers who are struggling with issues like these?
A few things. The UHF signals don't propagate as well over the hills. the VHF, the advantages they do a better job at getting over the hills. So from that standpoint, there are advantages to UHF. On the other hand, the UHF signals, and not to get too technical, you have smaller wavelengths. They are better at getting through the windows, for example. The VHF signals have longer wavelengths and don't do as well at getting into the buildings. So you've got trade-offs on each band. The digital signals, part of the reason that we were able to recover the spectrum that we did is they use less power and you can pack them more closely together. But that also means you have less margin to play with before you go off the edge of the cliff. So somebody who may have been able to receive a signal with their antenna not adjusted correctly in analog may have been able to get by. But once you go to digital, you may find you have to do some adjustment to it. So the basic messages we've tried to convey to consumers is first of all, rather than jumping straight to spend money that they don't need to, try what they have, adjust it, underscore that they need both VHF and UHF. We've got a number of tips to make sure you get the best performance out of your antenna so that if you're trying to take it and feed it to 2, 3, 4 sets, you're not going to have as good a chance at success. And then lastly, we've tried to give some tips on some people will need a new antenna, and to try to educate the community so that the retailers can make sure that the consumers, when they come in, get the right advice for the antennas that they need.
Good. Thank you very much. Commissioner Adelstein.
Thank you. And, of course, always, you never have to apologize for using your BlackBerry here. We're the FCC, after all, and that's why we sold all that spectrum, for just that purpose. But on a more serious note, I was a little concerned. I mean, you said 69% of the population is going to have access to an analog nightlight, but that means 31% isn't. It's a pretty substantial amount of the population. And I'm kind of wondering how many of those markets are just incapable of it for technical reasons of having anybody eligible to provide it, and how many of them can we still try to get folks to sign up in the next 9 days?
I believe off the top of my head there were only one or two markets where there were no eligible stations. That's my recollection. I can double check that. It was a very small number. So it's really a matter of trying to get more stations to participate, which is why we have held off on putting out the list in the hope that more stations will volunteer to participate in this important program. So we've been pushing, our field staff has been pushing with the broadcasters they're working with. As I say, MSTV, NAB, and APTS have been encouraging people. Very much appreciate the three of you having your encouraging words today. So it's more a matter of getting them to agree to do it rather than a problem with eligibility.
I would beg people to do it. I mean, it's really critical that consumers have this. Otherwise, those who are left out have no way to get information about analog. Particularly, I hope that in disaster-prone areas, particularly in hurricane areas, that all communities that are in the path of potential hurricanes have analog nightlight stations as well, and that all of those communities will find a volunteer. And if they need to pool their resources, that's wonderful. I appreciate David Donovan and MSTV's efforts and NAB, but we need to redouble them. We don't have much time left now. And if we can get stations, please, 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 to do that, it would really potentially be a lifesaver for consumers. Going on the line, Kathy, we still have these holdouts here. Who are these holdouts? I mean, why can't we get to this last group? Who's left, and what can we do to get to them, you think, in the last 9 days?
I think the remaining households that are not yet prepared fall into two groups. The first group are the procrastinators that I think with every transition we've experienced so far, you find that group of people. But probably the more important group are the people who are in more at-risk constituency groups, people who are either low-income, people living in really, really rural areas, people maybe who don't have English as their first language, and a number of senior citizens who may need help actually getting to the store to purchase the box as well as help getting the box installed. So that's why the programs, or rather the events and the activities that the field folks have been engaged in in recent weeks really has been targeted to reaching people where they are. And so we're no longer holding events and saying the FCC is going to be here, come see us, and we'll tell you all about the transition and help you prepare. But it's more, we're going to where we know they are. We're going to their church events. We're going out to shopping malls on big sale weekends, like Memorial Day weekend, when we knew there were a number of people that would be out shopping. We're going to, you know, different events where they're going to be there to hopefully help them on the spot. And I think those are the real categories. The procrastinators, I think we've seen that in each transition. But interestingly, I don't think that the call volume to our call center, at least following those transitions, was significantly affected by the number of people who procrastinated. You know what I mean? Like, it didn't go up as much as you would think based on the number of people who weren't prepared prior to that time frame. So I think they will prepare as soon as they experience the loss in their analog. They'll either install the converter box that they'd already purchased but hadn't yet tried to install, or they'll go get the converter box.
One of the things I've been so thrilled about is we got the AmeriCorps program up and running. Can you give us an update on how they're doing? Are they getting out to a lot of communities? They have a lot planned for the last 9 days here?
Definitely so, and as it was unfortunate that the video wasn't working earlier, but yes, the AmeriCorps volunteers are still out there and around in their four different campus areas. Bill can probably speak to the exact number of communities that they're involved in, but they continue to have a very, very favorable reception by people whose homes they go into to help them install and get the converter box working. And similarly, the same sorts of reactions to the firefighters and again, even the contractors that are working with the FCC out there doing those in-home installations. People, I think Roger or one of the folks said at the last meeting, people are immensely grateful to have that hands-on assistance in a situation that they find, frankly, quite terrifying. And so it's been a real, I think, success in terms of those partnerships.
Bill, you have any numbers on that?
With our contractors and our volunteers from AmeriCorps and from the firefighters, we've done tens of thousands of installs. I don't have an exact number because they roll in every day, but it's been really remarkable the way these folks have pulled together and gotten the word out into their communities. Part of it is making sure all of this is local, making sure that the people in the local community know that the help is there. And that's one of the things we're concentrating on now. We have the troops in the field, and what's most important is to get the word out to the local people that the help is there for them.
Right. In terms of our call center, Andrew, do you have any idea what kind of call projections we're anticipating post June 12th? I mean, obviously, right after June 12th, probably June 13th is going to be a real spike for us. And in the days after, what sense of projections do you have for the post June 12th date?
I've got lots of projections. Well, we're looking that we could go as high as half a million calls on June 13th. Is kind of what we're looking at right now. There's a lot of, as markets transition or as stations transition, we've been looking at the call volume in those specific markets to see what has happened. What seems to happen in some locations is we tend to have a larger tail. So where there are very little or very few calls before the date of a station or a large chunk of the market transitioning in some locations, shortly thereafter and up to maybe 2 to 3 weeks after that, we see an increase in call volume coming from those locations. So there has been no tight correlation between whether that's an accurate predictor for what's going to happen for beyond June 13th, but we realize that that's a potential and that's something that we need to plan for. So, you know, we're allowing right now in our plan to cover for a couple days at a high capacity after June 13th. It's, you know, still working on the details as far as how far beyond June 13th we keep at a given level.
Based on that potential and keeping with the chairman's encouragement to over-prepare rather than under-prepare, do you think we can handle the volume in sort of some of the worst-case scenarios given the current amount of funding we have, or are we going to need more funding in order to meet the demand?
In order to keep with the chairman's approach and hit that demand, we'll need more funding.
Thank you. Bernie, I appreciate your impeccable safety record. We're very enviable from an FCC perspective, I must say. The question I had for you is about on the coupon redemption rate. Are they coming in pretty fast? Do you think, based on the current redemption rates we're seeing, that there's any chance of running out of coupons in the end, or are we gonna make it?
Well, in terms of the ones that are actually being redeemed, the redemption rate's gone down a little bit over the past few weeks. If you look at the actual weeks, it's like in the 40s where it had been up in the 50s and the 60s. We've checked with the retailers. It's not a question of inventory, but it has gone down, and what we are thinking is perhaps the people are particularly the procrastinators who waited and waited, or perhaps getting sets instead. But we have not, we were not getting complaints about lack of converter box inventory. So it appears that we will have enough coupons. And again, well, I always say this very cautiously, very optimistically, because you just don't know. Where we are, we look at this very carefully. Every week we sit down and make a determined effort, whether, because one of the things that we could do if we were running out of coupons is say, okay, the only people who get it are households that certify that they are over the air only, that the only way they can get any TV is with rabbit ears. Right this week, we have enough coupons left to serve 4.5 million households. We also know that there are 1.5 million over-the-air households who have an active coupon. And the Nielsen number said that there are 3.1 million over-the-air. So we have enough coupons to serve everyone who's over-the-air. So we're not going to pull the trigger, and we're going to continue to everybody who asks for coupons will be able to get a coupon. So I believe we do have enough coupons to get us through the 12th and hopefully to the 31st.
Thank you.
Good. I just wanted to echo what Jonathan said in highlighting night lighting. I think that night light service is really, it's really important. It's a voluntary program, but I think it's really the essence of public interest and public service, and I hope that more stations will sign on to do that, because it can be, as Jonathan said, a matter of public safety and life and death. Commissioner McDowell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Martin, I wanted to kind of drill down further on some of the questions that Commissioner Adelstein was asking you based on our lessons from May 21st and the spike in call volume then. So ideally, how many operators would you need and for what period of time? For instance, just to set it up for other folks in the room, as we're finding, and please correct me if I'm wrong, we're finding a ramping up now of call volume as consumers become more aware and more concerned in a good way about June 12th that's coming. So every day more and more calls are coming into our call center. I think one of the lessons learned, and please correct me if I'm wrong, on June the 12th, that actually once the signals are pulled off is when you see spikes. So it's not until after those analog signals are shut off do you actually see these huge spikes in call volume. So based on those projections, how many operators are you going to need, and when are you going to need that to be ramped up? A couple days before June 12th all the way through a week or 8 days later, or how long?
Well, I'll use June 12th. Well, I'll use May 21st as an example. So May 21st, we saw I'll separate daily volume and daily capacity from, you know, say, more granular, you know, 10-minute interval capacity. So during the soft tests, there's a soft test usually occurred around, you know, the 30-minute mark of the hour, and I'll use the 6:30 Eastern Standard Time, 6:30 p.m. as an indication. The way the call volume flowed during that time frame is at 6:20, I had 500 calls in a 10-minute incremental. At 6:30, I had 3,400 calls in a 10-minute increment. At 6:40, I had 2,500 calls in a 10-minute increment. And then at 6:50, I had 500 calls again. So you can see there's a dramatic spike in a short period of time when that signal is not available. In order to handle that in what I would consider a more reasonable within our standards of performance, we would have needed our 4,000 agents on at that time frame for that, you know, 20-minute period. What we also saw during that time frame is the consumer's desire to hang on the phone, for lack of a better term, at what point they start abandoning, is averaging around 5 minutes and 12 seconds in times of high call volume.
So if they're waiting, if they're on hold for over 5 minutes, they start just dropping off the call.
That's correct. So if you look at a call, you know, an average call time somewhere in the neighborhood of, we're targeting 10 minutes, you could have, with the 4,000 agents, gotten close to addressing that volume within, you know, 20 to 30 seconds a wait time. So to the extent that the May 21st event speaks to what we can expect when we have what on June 12th, 13th, and so on, the 4,000 agents is probably where we need to be. The interesting thing is May 21st event was a very announced event, if you will. The consumer was provided information, contact, you know, this number if you're seeing this message. The June 12th information will be somewhat different. So I expect that the volume will still be there. It may more likely be distributed throughout the day. But seeing what the night light or seeing what the turnoff time frames are, where we're seeing for lack of a better term, close to 50% or just under 50% of the stations choosing the 6 p.m. to midnight time frame. I expect that during that time frame on June 12th, we'll be getting a lot of we'll either be getting a lot of calls in or very early the next morning when the children wake up and they can't see their cartoons, start waking their parents up. The summer poses another interesting event. We're in a very active time for many families, many consumers, and in addition to vacations, people's schedules seem to be a little less predictable after the Memorial Day break. So that, with that factor in there, it's very likely that the TV viewing habits are not as predictable as they are, say, perhaps during a May sweeps time frame, and that may drag out the tail a little longer. The current plan, to be more specific, we can operate roughly at that 4,000 capacity, and that the plan runs us to the 15th or the 16th of June, so the following Monday, Tuesday, depending upon how we are. At that point, we have to start ramping down to a much lower level of agent staffing in order to continue support through the end of the June 30th initial contract timeframe.
Okay, so during that 8 or 10 day period before and after June 12th, you're going to need more bodies, and we right now have a funding requirement for that, and we don't have commitment for that funding. Is that correct? So, how much money would you need to fund it to the degree where you're satisfied?
In order to maintain the 4,000 agent staffing level, let's say for 10 days after the June 12th event through, that would be June 22nd, you're looking at, do the rough calculations, somewhere up to $10 million at the high end. You could likely come in there less depending upon how you deal with the staffing plan.
And currently, how much money do we have authorized?
For this particular...
For the call center right
for
now?
For the call center, we are operating under a $30 million budget.
No, but for the remainder, so for that time period, you said you need $10 million to ramp that up. So of that $10 million additional that you need, how much do we have?
I don't have that.
You have million. Zero?
Correct.
You have zero of that $10
million. That's correct.
In order for the call center to be adequately staffed, we have no resources for that.
Beyond the 16th, yes, sir.
Okay. Where does that money come from?
Department of Commerce, NTIA.
Okay. Dr. McGuire Rivera, where...
Here's your check.
Okay. Thank you. I could take care of it.
So everyone will understand. Let me go. The Recovery Act says that of the $650 million for the extension of the transition, $90 million of it can be used for education and outreach. And then the Recovery Act further provides that this amount can be transferred to the FCC if deemed necessary and appropriate by the Secretary of Commerce in consultation with the FCC, and only if the committees on the appropriation of the House and Senate are notified not less than 5 days in advance of the transfer of such funds. Originally, we did not transfer the entire $90 million to the FCC. $25 million was held back out of concern that we would not have enough money to fulfill all the coupon requests. At this point, in fact, it was yesterday, we have got the entire amount of information that the Secretary needs to make his determination. We have received the formal transfer request. It was submitted promptly to the Secretary for his determination.
When was that submitted?
It was submitted
yesterday. Yesterday. Okay. And so is that 5 business days Congress needs, or is it 5 calendar days?
The law doesn't say.
Okay, it just says days.
To mean calendar days.
A day is a day. Okay. If it's not, it doesn't say business day. All right. So, but that is after the Secretary makes that determination. Okay. So how many days until the transition?
9.
Okay. So when is the Secretary going to make that determination?
That is way above my pay grade.
What can we do to help encourage him to release that money? I mean, over half of the calls we get, and correct me if I'm wrong, about 51%, Mr. Martin, are for the coupon program. And this is the one lifeline that also folks have. Chief Knapp did a great job of outlining the antenna issues and the rescanning issues that we're going to have after June 12th. So these are going to be trained operators who are trained to answer such technical questions as well. So this is the major lifeline the American public is going to have to get these questions answered. I don't think there's probably a better tool for outreach and education well within the intent of the statute. So what do I need to do to help convince the Secretary to help him?
Well, the major thing I think that will help him make his determination is the good data that Mr. Lake and Mr. Martin have put together on the call center. A call wouldn't hurt. And I'm sure that they're listening to this.
Hi.
But
could you please send us our $10 million? Thank you. Hopefully my colleagues will join with me in that request.
But the process is in order. It is going. They have the information that they need. And I have not heard anything that there would be an adverse reaction to this.
Well, we'll be following up on this as the clock ticks. Very good. That's the extent of my questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you, everyone on the panel, for your good presentations today and for the tremendous work you all are doing to help move this forward. And, Madam Secretary, would you call the next panel, please? Okay. We're going to take a two-minute break while the new panel comes up here. come to order, please. She already announced the panel, right?
I think she did.
So we've got Jane, Larry, Dave, Kyle, where's Joe, Chris? Okay. Okay, we welcome the second panel. We have a number of people to be heard from, and as you can see, a high level of interest in asking questions up here. So I would ask if each of you could hold your formal presentations to maybe no more than 5 minutes, if that's possible. And we'll begin with our friend Jane Mago.
Good morning, Chairman Copps, Commissioners Adelstein and McDowell. Thank you for the opportunity to report on broadcaster efforts toward the smooth transition to an all-digital television world. As you know, our joint efforts, which include, okay, it's that one, all right, get the right microphone. It's always a tough time, you know. Our joint efforts, including the broadcaster's $1.2 billion consumer education campaign, with our on-the-ground initiatives, coalition building, and extensive messaging, have produced stunning results. Today, national awareness of the DTV transition is nearly universal at 98%. Compare that to NAB's first DTV poll in 2005, which reported only a 25% awareness rate. We've come a long way. And importantly, our most recent information shows that nearly 89% of the over-the-air households have taken some action to get ready, with 82% of those fully prepared for the transition. Also encouraging, as you heard earlier, we found that the gap in awareness and preparedness for African Americans, Hispanics, and the elderly versus the general population is indeed closing significantly. This success is the direct result of a major group effort that involves each and every member of the people on this panel today. My colleagues, along with you, have all played vital roles in our coalition to spread the word and help viewers prepare for this historic transition. We want to say thank you to all. Let me touch just briefly on the May 21st soft test that you heard about earlier, and note that NAB collaborated very closely with the FCC and state broadcaster associations on this effort. And indeed, as you noted, the test was very successful in compelling viewers to take action, to make calls, and figure out what they needed to know. It also served as a necessary and useful trial run for the National Call Center. On the following day, May 22nd, America's broadcasters kicked off a massive new on-air campaign. New DTV countdown spots, produced and distributed by NAB, are airing on full power stations. Please allow me to show you one of those spots that walks the viewers through the process of upgrading to DTV. Can we start that?
Welcome to the digital world.
If you watch antenna TV, get a new digital set or converter box like this. Read the manual, and once you've set it up and scanned for channels, test your antenna. Move it around like this. If you don't get a clear signal, you may need a new VHF-UHF antenna. Finally, make sure to rescan after June 12th to get all available channels. Press menu on your remote and choose the scan function.
Learn more at DTVAnswers.com or phone 888-CALL-FCC.
I think you can see that it's not easy to get that all that much information into a 30-second spot, but I think they did a great job with it. Now, of course, broadcasters will continue airing news stories and messages and that highlight the information that consumers need on antennas, rescanning, installing converter boxes, and dealing with signal loss. Through NAB's innovative partnerships, these informative DTV spots are running not just on television, but in gas stations, auto service centers, grocery stores, on airplanes, and they're reaching millions of consumers on the go. I also note that radio stations are stepping up to the plate and airing spots about the DTV transition, And importantly, in light of the conversation we had just a moment ago, I note that they will also be in a position where they will be able to provide emergency information in the areas that are affected by the transition. One more shout out. Our state broadcasters and many, many FCC officials have done a tremendous job of coordinating in the field. For example, Bob Fisher of the Nevada Broadcasters Association and the Commission's Karen Beverly have covered just about every corner of that state of Nevada. Those have been working really hard. Similarly, Bill Klein, who's the East Regional Coordinator, was on WKYC-TV in Cleveland talking about the DTV transition. And local broadcasters are promoting DTV walk-in centers by airing PSAs and covering all of them in news activities, and they're preparing to take the local calls, Commissioner McDowell, over when the transition happens. Now, despite all of our coordinated efforts, we know that challenges lie ahead, and we are preparing. In fact, NAB's pollster is currently in the field conducting the final DTV study, which we expect will provide useful insights into 11th hour activities regarding the transition. These survey results will be available next week. Based on our research, we're focusing specifically on scanning and antennas, and we have videos that are particularly designed towards that. In closing, let me recognize that for a myriad of reasons, as you've all said this morning, there will be a group of people who will not upgrade to DTV before June 12th. This is inevitable. But thanks to the unprecedented public-private partnership that we've all engaged in, they will have known about it. Whether they choose to get ready before or after the deadline, the American viewers will experience the benefits of free digital television, crystal clear pictures, phenomenal sound, and more channels and services than ever before, free over the air. Thank you for your leadership. And for inviting me here today, I'm happy to take any questions that you have.
Thank you very much. And I was remiss at the outset in not identifying your affiliation. Jane is Executive Vice President and General Counsel of the National Association of Broadcasters. Next, we will hear from Larry Sedman, who is President and CEO of the Association of Public Television Stations. Larry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Copps and Commissioners Adelstein and McDowell, thank you for the opportunity to appear this morning on behalf of the nation's locally owned and operated public television stations. The reinvigorated oversight of the DTV transition this year by the Obama administration, Congress, and the FCC has gone a long way to ensure a more seamless DTV conversion. In particular, the delay in the DTV conversion urged by the new administration and enacted by the Congress in the DTV Delay Act has not only given consumers four additional months to adapt, but perhaps more significantly, as Chairman Copps noted, has created a phased DTV conversion as opposed to a nationwide flash cut. The public television community is especially appreciative of the manner in which the Commission implemented the DTV Delay Act to enable many local public television stations suffering unprecedented economic hardship to shut off analog before June 12. Together with the May 21st soft test and other soft shutoffs of analog, this staggered DTV conversion has provided useful insights into how best to ensure that all Americans, especially the elderly and historically underserved communities, including minorities, non-English speakers, and rural residents, have access to digital television services. They cannot be stranded. Permit me to share some of the lessons public television stations have learned. First, on-air education is working. At this late stage, and as the NAB spot pointed out, information about potential service loss areas and the need for rescanning converter boxes is particularly useful. Public television stations have invested major resources in very hard times on these efforts. For example, KNME in Albuquerque, New Mexico, which we noted is number one on the target area and which Commissioner Adelstein visited when he was out in New Mexico recently working on smoothing out the DTV transition, has spent more than $400,000 in airtime and production costs alone working on consumer education. Second, In addition to the FCC's national call center, we recommend that stations or groups of stations staff their own local helplines or call centers to field inquiries from local viewers. For example, Iowa Public Television will have a call center of 16 phones. More than 50 staffers from all parts of the state have been trained by the station's chief engineer and will work around the clock in shifts to help ensure a more comfortable transition. Third, walk-in centers and in-home assistance for converter box and antenna installation and operation, particularly for the elderly, are critically important. In broadband, the mantra was last mile to the home. In the DTV conversion, it's all about the last meter to the television set. We applaud the Commission for the grassroots initiatives and contracts it has awarded to fulfill these needs. Though the preference for for-profit small businesses and the award of the recent round of contracts unfortunately prevented willing public television stations from playing a greater role in this program, we are pleased that two public television stations did obtain such contracts and are working hard to provide expert and basic in-home assistance. Fourth and finally, public television stations' early transitions have underscored one inescapable reality. No matter what they do, some viewers, especially in rural or mountainous areas, will not be able to get all the same stations they did before the transition because of differences between analog and digital technologies. And that, of course, was the subject of the colloquy between the chairman and Mr. Knapp. Stations need to be prepared to respond to these viewers and work toward expanding service and filling in service gaps. We commend the Commission for its recent adoption of rules for the new replacement translator service, including expanding the construction period to 3 years. To ensure that these rules will fulfill their intended purpose, we are urging Congress to restore the Public Telecommunications Facilities Program at NTIA and the Public Television Digital Transition Grant Program of the Rural Utilities Service, which have been proposed for elimination in the administration's FY 2010 budget. Thank you very much for the opportunity to address you this morning, and I look forward to answering any questions you might have.
Thank you, Larry. Next, we will hear from David Donovan, who is president of MSTV. David?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner McDowell, Commissioner Adelstein, and congratulations, Commissioner McDowell, on your recent nomination. I'm delighted to appear before you today to discuss a digital transition which will be completed, and I want to understand, completed in 9 days. And I want to thank you, Chairman Copps, your fellow commissioners, your personal staffs, and the staffs of the Media Bureau and OET for tremendous amount of work over the last few months. Putting the Commission's focus on this transition has meant all the difference. And we do, from the bottom of our hearts in the industry, want to thank you for it. The private-public partnership has worked. Over the last several weeks, actually over the last several months, MSTV and its engineering staff and our engineering committee have shifted into high gear. We continue to have, it's not just regular scheduled meetings, it's one long meeting that really never ends as emails are going back and forth. This has been an important source for disseminating information. MSTV continues to provide technical coordination with the cable and the satellite industries. And I want to thank Kyle McSlero, NCTA, and the American Cable Association for the coordination efforts with television stations. That's often an unknown or an underappreciated part of this transition, and the coordination efforts between the two industries have been terrific. Yesterday's Commission's decision to allow stations to transition earlier in the day will help, because if problems arise, we'll be able to call the cable folks or the satellite folks, and people will be at work as opposed to, you know, very late in the evening. So we think that will be helpful. We've also worked extensively with DirecTV and Dish, and I want to thank those companies as well. We learned on February 17th that one of the problems with some satellite systems that get a signal over the air, consumers use the program guide to tune all their channels seamlessly, which requires additional coordination between the broadcasters, Tribune Media Service, which provides the programming material, and the satellite industry. We have worked out our coordination efforts through them, and that should be okay. As mentioned in the morning, throughout the hearing, we have been working closely with the Media Bureau to facilitate and promote the analog nightlight program. I am happy to report that 42 of the 49 targeted hotspot markets will have at least one analog nightlight station. In some of the remaining markets, there are simply no options available. In some instances, some of the stations that had agreed to do nightlight early, frankly, went off in February 17th, and so those transmitters are gone. There are others that have, that may be on the list, that have unique technical problems. We are literally, the Rolodex is on fire, going through station by station to urge participation in this program. And I do want to thank the television stations that have agreed to step up and participate and to bear significant operational costs for this voluntary program. I commit to you that we will continue to try to increase the number of stations that are participating across the board. At our last hearing, we talked about problems with UHF reception, and since that time, the Commission has approved a translator fill-in service and also DTS, and we support those efforts. These are important tools that can be used to provide full coverage. But as with any new technology, it will take time to work out all the reception and interference issues. Quality reception is based on three factors: the signal, the equipment used to receive the signal, and the interference environment. Now, if we look at where we will be at the end of the transition after June 12th, 2.2% of the stations will be in the low VH band, channels 2 to 5. 25% will be in the high VHF band, and 72% will be in the UHF band, which makes the UHF television band the most crowded and intensely used band in just about all of spectrum. But you have 25%. Or actually, it's 27.2% of all stations will be in the VHF band. And what we've learned is that there are some additional issues that we need to address. We have some experience. You have about 152 stations that are operating in digital on VHF. And we've learned some things. Low VHF channels are going to cause or have some low impulse noise issues. For some stations, increasing power for both V and U's may provide a solution, but you have interference issues to consider. And it's going to vary from market to market. Using the correct antenna is extremely important, and we can discuss that further. But there is one overarching lesson we have learned, and Julie alluded to it in his testimony when he talked about the margins. Whether it's low impulse noise or other forms of ambient noise, interference is the key issue in digital. The manifestation of interference in digital is far more significant than in analog. It's not wavy lines. You lose the picture. So I hope we focus on that issue as we move forward to improve service, but also in dealing with additional transmitting devices that are going to be placed in the television band. The interference issue is absolutely key. We're focused on the problems, but I think one thing we shouldn't lose sight of is that this digital system overall works very, very well. Viewers are amazed at the quality of HD. They are amazed at the additional viewing options that are being made available. And indeed, during these tough economic times, the completion of a free, over-the-air, universally available digital service is perhaps the most pro-consumer action taken by this entity in decades. And for that, we pledge to work with you, and we look forward to answering any of your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Dave. Another gentleman who I think his Rolodex has been on fire, too, and helping us navigate through the shoals of the transition is Kyle McSlara, who is president and the CEO of the National Cable and Telecommunications Association.
Thank you. And I can probably be mercifully brief, keeping your admonition in mind. No need to duplicate much of what my colleagues have already said, but I do want to start out by thanking you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners Adelstein and McDowell, for your leadership. As has been said by others, the fact that, while mindful that there will still be challenges ahead, that we have ensured the successful activities that we've had to date is in no small measure due to your leadership. And I also want to compliment my colleagues here at the table, and in particular David Donovan, so right back at you on the coordination. It has been extraordinary. It's not often seen. These are engineers talking to engineers. I have no clue what they're talking about, but somehow they make it all work. And I want to thank the FCC staff, who I know has worked extraordinarily hard over the last few months. Just a snapshot, since we had a status report before you in early March, of sort of activities from that point to now. As you know, the call center operation, the joint government industry call center operation, we kept going, and in that period of time up to about April 20th, when the funding gap at the federal level was very real, we kept hundreds of live agents in a trusted advisor capacity, but then we were able to do the complete handoff to the government-run call center operation. So our focus has really shifted almost entirely now to the awareness, education, and then collaboration and coordination campaigns that my colleagues have been talking about. Couple points. One, some questions have been asked about whether or not cable operators would continue, as we were asked by you and policymakers, to make available very low-cost, affordable offers on the broadcast basic package. To my knowledge, all of NCTA's members have continued and extended those offers so that they would extend through June 12th. The war room operation that we had around the February 17th first effort on the digital transition, we're next week going to reestablish at NCTA. We are plugged in with NAB, MSTV, the American Cable Association. It'll be 24/7. And that's really designed to be a two-way communication. We want to know if there are problems our guys are seeing in the field so that we can communicate to you if we need assistance. But it's also a one-stop shop, at least in terms of our industry. If you have questions or you're hearing either through the call center or otherwise, and you have questions, that we can fan out and get those questions answered or deal with any problems that arise. If there are any other activities that you think would suggest that we should take a look at, we're open. I think we're on top of it. And again, thank you for your leadership.
Thank you very much. Next, we'll hear from Joel Kelsey, who's a policy analyst at Consumers Union and has been very much involved in this transition since day one.
Good morning, Chairman Copps, Commissioners Adelstein and McDowell. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today. 6 months ago, Consumers Union wrote Congress with grave concerns about the nation's preparedness for the transition to digital television. We were concerned that millions of consumers were stranded on a waiting list for converter box coupons from the Commerce Department, millions more were still unprepared for the switch, and more still remained confused about how to navigate the transition. However, this potential debacle was averted. Congress listened and responded by passing the DTV Delay Act of 2009. Under the new leadership of Acting Chairman Copps, and with just over 3 months to pick up the pieces of a disorganized education campaign, the FCC has responded quickly and effectively. We applaud Chairman Copps for working closely with Commissioners Adelstein and McDowell to focus and coordinate the agency's management of the DTV transition. And in our view, there were three critical actions that really created this pivot moment at the agency. First was better hotlines. Working with industry partners, the FCC was able to coordinate the various numbers out there, and here's the key part, get better trained operatives at the other end of those lines to answer all of the questions that consumers had, so they didn't have to call one line for coupon questions and another one for hookup questions. That was a key point. Second is more hands-on assistance. Based on the success in many media markets that transitioned early, the FCC worked with community centers in a comprehensive way to create walk-in centers to provide on-site help to consumers that were having trouble navigating the transition, and that was key. Lastly is better information about signal coverage. And this is, I'd like to in particular point out the consumer-facing side. Besides just pointing to antennaweb.org, the FCC was able to develop consumer-facing materials that helped those experiencing signal issues. In particular, the new web function that shows a consumer the anticipated strength of full-power digital signals is very important in helping consumers that are trying to figure out whether or not they need a new antenna. We've come a long way. In our annual survey, the Consumer Reports National Research Center posed a number of DTV-related questions to just over 38,000 of our readers. Of the respondents, we found that 85% were prepared for the transition to digital broadcast. That's of our readers that rely on over-the-air broadcasts, which is about 12%, very close to the national average. Millions of consumers have been able to access the federal coupon program and prepare for the transition due to the Delay Act and the subsequent hard work of FCC and NTIA. However, there's still much work to be done in the 9 days between today and June 12th and afterwards. Reception and signal issues continue to loom large with consumers. Among the respondents who relied on free over-the-air broadcasts and indicated that they were prepared for the transition, consumer reports found that 16% had to purchase a new indoor antenna, 8% had to install a new outdoor antenna to receive an adequate signal, 17% reported losing some channels, 20% found it difficult to get their antenna to receive the stations they were supposed to get when they answered our survey. So we urge the agency to continue to prioritize the education efforts that have been a game changer really up to this point when helping consumers troubleshoot the reception problems. Although much has changed in the few months since a crisis loomed in February, some issues have stayed the same. We continue to receive consumer complaints resulting from incomplete and sometimes what we find misleading advertisements by some cable companies, which present cable subscriptions as the primary option to navigate the transition and failing to mention other low-cost options available to consumers. For example, our colleagues at Consumer Reports Money Blog pointed to a Cablevision ad that modeled the public service announcement, which has been around and criticized for some time. The company offers a deal to those that want to sign up for cable service, but when our editors called, they offered a $53 a month plan that climbs to $73 after the first year of service. And it took quite a bit amount of probing to get the representative to even mention their cheapest basic plan, which was $17 a month with a $34 installation fee. For consumers, this transition is complicated enough without ads taking advantage of the confusion. We urge cable companies to stop using this mandated transition as an advertising opportunity and join other industry partners in educating consumers about all the possible available options. Lastly, I'll quickly note that we continue to hear from community groups whose members report being sold more expensive and sometimes unnecessary equipment by retailers. The federally mandated DTV transition should be an opportunity not to make money on the backs of cash-strapped consumers, but to work in a socially responsible way with their communities. There's some retailers out there, Mosquito Productions in Minnesota, Fred Meyer in Seattle, a few HEBs and Best Buys in Texas, that have signed a no-cost box pledge, committing to their communities to keep a $40 box on the shelves through the transition. We think this is a great thing, and we urge other retailers throughout the nation to do the same. With that, I'll end and welcome any questions you have and note that we continue to remain committed to working with the agency through June 12th and afterwards to help consumers navigate the transition. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel. And we welcome back from the Consumer Electronics Retailers Coalition its Executive Director, Chris McLean.
Thank you very much. On behalf of CERC and its members who make up America's favorite places to shop for consumer electronics, I'd like to express our sincere appreciation to the Commission, to the National Telecommunications Information Administration, the White House, and our industry partners for outstanding leadership in an endeavor requiring unprecedented cooperation between government, industry, and the public at large. While it is still too soon for a victory lap, it is not too soon to say thank you to all of those who have worked so long and hard on this transformation of television. And a special thank you to you, Mr. Chairman, for taking full ownership of the DTV transition and the remarkable progress that you have made under your leadership. This has been a multi-year initiative. CERC is very proud to be part of this amazing effort. CERC has been an early and active member of the DTV Transition Coalition, and all CERC members participate in the NTIA DTV Converter Box program. Our members have also enjoyed an excellent working relationship with the FCC and its staff and commissioners on a host of community outreach events all across our country. Now, like a marathon, Wilmington, Western Nebraska, Hawaii were among the first to complete the race. And in February, a large batch of stations and communities recorded personal bests as they entered into the digital future. And now in the coming days, we'll bring the largest mass of contestants across the finish line. But as in any race, there will be a few stragglers who may take a little extra time to complete the task. And for those who feel like giving up, they just need to ask for help, and they'll make it too. During our last gathering, I was pressed by the chairman about converter box supply. And prior to today's hearing, CERC's counsel, Robert Schwartz, under the protection of attorney-client privilege, polled our membership and provided me with a report of our members' general readiness for the waning days of analog television. From a retail perspective, I have some serious news to report. Some of our members are concerned about converter box supply. They're concerned that they have too many boxes on hand. So we're welcome visitors into our stores. Our shelves are stocked. Buy one for grandma. We're ready and willing and able to serve you. So our supply concerns are fortunately on the plus side. And I am pleased to report that our members feel generally prepared for the final days of analog and the dawn of digital television. Now, for consumers, please do not interpret my general optimism to mean that you should wait till the last minute to make the digital transition. What lies ahead truly is uncharted territory. While I observe no evidence of shortage, it is possible that on any given day and at any given store, the product you want may be out of stock. Just like the 9 shopping days before Christmas, the most popular items will move off of our shelves. And we also know the day after Christmas is an explosion of activity, and we're ready for that. I urge customers not to delay. Visit your favorite consumer electronics